Well, it's very realistic, I think. But we were talking about some projects which Susan mentioned, that Pavel and Matt in Montreal. He actually is a driving force. He has plenty of good ideas besides arms control and other things. No, Matt, it's your choice to mention some of those projects that we can help to promote and bring some insanity, not insanity, sanity, yeah.
Bring some Freudian.
Insanity, right.
Yeah, we'll actually, try to put some water on the fires of insanity. Yeah, I'll do my best in the short time I have allotted here to speak amongst these other eminent speakers. Thank you very much, Ed, for giving me the opportunity to present here a very short thing. As far as I understand it, there are students who will be also watching, and it's to them that I've also sort of configured some of the thoughts in my mind that I'm going to share. I don't think anyone really went into this days ago thinking that we were going to have some final result of the elections. And certainly when you just look at the amount of anomalies that have cooked up, that I mean, votes appearing, hundreds of thousands of votes appearing in Michigan or Wisconsin in the middle of the night that are all attributed to one person, and a whole variety of other anomalies. There are, I think, legitimate grounds for dispute, and there will be disputes. This will be brought to the courts, and we don't know how many days or weeks or longer. We will have to wait until some resolution occurs. We also have matters of anarchy. I think most of us are aware of the color revolutionary elements active currently inside the United States that could get very ugly very quickly. There's a lot of kindling. So I don't really want to go into the details on that stuff. That is material that's out there. I think what I could probably provide for some of the students who are listening again would be a little bit of context. We sometimes get a little bit lost analyzing the trees in the forest and lose sight of the whole. I'm going to do a little bit of that shortly. One thing that did come up that Jim brought up is the fact that we do have a clash between a unipolar way of thinking and a multipolar system. And I think this is the sort of period systemically that we're caught in a turbulent moment between two systems. We sort of have the end game period of the last several decades of globalization, a certain way of organizing society has reached a bit of a boundary condition. And we have an underdefined new system which will be brought online. We don't know what it's going to look like. We do have certain nations among Eurasia, Russia, China, a growing number of nations working on the Belt and Road Initiative that are really representing a multipolar way of thinking. And this is not something which is very arithmetic. I mean, we tend to get sometimes caught in arithmetic thinking, balancing the equations, looking for balance, which is what dominated the Cold War. These nations working in that system are very much committed to a certain type of coordinated disequilibrium. Industrial growth, scientific and technological progress are really driving the Belt and Road Initiative, these large-scale mega projects that we haven't seen in the West in many, many decades. I wasn't even born. It was before my time that our nations in the West were building things that were big. They're doing that now, and it's very different from the unipolar way of organizing society. It's a different operating system. I think that overall, Russia, China, other nations of that bent would like very much for the West, especially the United States, to be a partner in this sort of new system. I think that the issue of trust that's been brought up is very important because they have not seen the United States or many countries of the NATO sort of cage behaving in their own self-interest for a very long time. I mean, you have to make quite the sophisticated argument to try to push the idea that the United States is more safe because of the war on terrorism, or because of the color revolutions, or because of the regime changes, or even because of the economic policies, frankly, of, you know, unleashing unbounded speculation in lieu of maintaining your infrastructure, investing in new infrastructure. Over four decades. I mean, the United States, as much as Canada, where I am, are not more secure. We have not been operating in our own self-interest. So we're not a very reliable partner in that type of multipolar alliance where every nation who is a part of it is expected to operate for the well-being or the interests of their own society. So that has to definitely change. There's no way, I don't think, you're going to get some resolution on the bigger picture if we don't get a realignment back to what is our real self-interest versus an illusory self-interest, which is actually destroying our future. Glenn Greenwald brought up something a few days before the elections that I think is very valuable, because why do people not think in these broader systemic terms? What prevents them? And Glenn Greenwald, I think everyone knows, he quit the media platform The Intercept that he himself co-founded in 2013. And he did this because he was simply trying to report the news. He was trying to report on the Hunter Biden laptop and some of the proven revelations that this creates regarding Joe Biden's lies and his role in this criminal network internationally, and a lot more too. So, you know, he was just trying to do journalism, write an article, and his own editors censored him and said, you're not allowed to bring in anything that implicates Biden, Joe. This broke his contract agreements, and he basically said that this is insane. And he quit, and he wrote a good article, and he also made a powerful quote. I'm just going to read a part of this where Greenwald writes, if Biden wins, that's going to be the power structure, a Democratic Party fully united with neocons, Bush-Cheney operatives, CIA, FBI, NSA, Wall Street, and Silicon Valley, presenting itself as the only protection against fascism, and much of the left will continue marching behind it. I think this is extremely valuable because Greenwald is not a pro-Trumper at all. He's a progressive. He's typically a Democrat. But he got it. He got the fact that we're being played between this left-right party politics, false dualism. And he understands that there's a higher issue, a higher thing above the party system, which is ready to label either Republican or Democrat, whether it's Trump or whether it's Tulsi Gabbard or Bernie Sanders, they are willing to label them a Russian agent and destroy them if possible. Why? Simply because they are human beings. These are people who have problems, but they have access to parts of their fundamental nature of being human and being American that would not make them very prone to acquiescing to being agents, puppets, of policies that will destroy their own people or republic. And because they're not of that bent, they would tend to resist or have different instincts. They're not acceptable to the thing that Glenn Greenwald has just called out. The military, industrial, congressional, intelligence, academic, media, think tank complex. I love that idea. Call it what you will, deep state, shadow government, call it what you want. It has different, but the point is it has a certain essence, nature. I think this is the same thing going back to history that labeled Republicans like Wendell Willkie as much as Henry Wallace and Paul Robeson and Franklin Roosevelt that wanted to label them all communists equally. Why? Because they were anti-imperialists, because they didn't believe in a world order that would be defined around U.S. hegemony. They didn't believe in it. They believed in cooperation amongst Russia, China, and the United States, working to extend development projects to allow former colonies to become full spectrum productive economies, just like the U.S. had also aimed to achieve in its better years. So everybody has the right to have protectionism, to have sovereign control of their development pathways. This is something that was believed in by John F. Kennedy as well, and by his brother Robert F. Kennedy, Robert Kennedy. And anybody who tries to evaluate American history without understanding this thing that Ray or that Glenn Greenwald discussed is not going to be able to get a full picture, and you won't be able to understand what took over America over the dead bodies of John F. Kennedy, of Robert, because when the dollar was floated in 1971 from the fixed exchange rates and from the gold reserve system onto the floating exchange rates, you had the creation of a whole new paradigm, which really created incentives for the US as well as other Western countries to undermine their own economic base. We started rewarding very short-term thinking, speculation in momentary little slivers of time at the expense of the future well-being of your society. We started exporting our productive base, our manufacturing, to increasingly cheap labor producers. And, you know, the world was defined around consumers who would be expected to just consume and not produce what they used to make, and producers who would be too poor to consume the things that they were producing, because that would be filling our dollar stores and our Walmarts. So the world was defined under this new sort of dichotomization. No one was allowed to stand on their own 2 feet. What's the consequence? Well, our infrastructure now, there's a $4.5 trillion infrastructure deficit in America. There's something similar in Canada and Europe. We haven't maintained these things. We've lost the ability to produce those things to build and maintain our own infrastructure under 40 years of globalization. These are things which have just created a complete upside down, topsy-turvy world where we've lost a sense of who we are. We became reliant on the oil, the petrodollar. Oil geopolitics became a new governing mechanism of global power politics. So this nation stripping has to be undone if the West is gonna become a reliable partner for Eurasia, for the multipolar alliance to trust in the long term. Trump, for all of his problems, and I'm not saying he didn't have them, I do hope that he succeeds in the oncoming battles over the disputes of the election results. I honestly, that's my view, is that he would be much preferable to the weird thing that's controlling Biden and many neocons as well. Trump has challenged NAFTA, some of the structures of the World Trade Organization, by giving nation states the power to have a say in their economic affairs. This was protectionist policies were illegal under NAFTA from 1994. That's changed now. The Trans-Pacific Partnership that would have given corporations the right to sue nations of the Pacific who disobeyed the free trade edicts. That is the first thing he killed. That was also an attack on China, the TPP. He's revived a serious space program orientation, which is very synergistic to the Russia-China space orientation. Both of these countries are very committed to driving space as the thing which will shape all of the innovation in their economies. They have a joint program to co-construct a lunar base. China has a program for mining the moon. So what Trump has done with the Artemis Accords is very synergistic to that. The revival of an idea of Arctic development, rather than militarizing the Arctic, Trump has supported the Alaska-Canada Railway, given federal backing or support to that. That's very, very different from Obama-Biden. That's a very different and very positive way of thinking, which brings things like, the Polar Silk Road closer to North America as something that will benefit all people on all sides of the continents. Cooperating with Russia on terrorism in Syria, the revival of manufacturing, that focus. These are all very important things that really get at, I think, the core cancer that has undermined our Western societies for a long time. So there's problems, big problems on the START Treaty, on these neocons, pushing a war policy against China. These are all big, major problems. I don't think they're going to be resolved with Biden. But I think that Trump started pushing in the right direction on a variety of very important full spectrum policies that I think have to be taken into consideration by anyone wishing to solve these problems. And I'll just, I think, leave it there.
Okay.